Hello friends, welcome back. My name is Ramon. How are you today? Today I'm going to be talking about a sunscreen that my boyfriend sent to me, and he was like, hey, do you follow this girl, Makeup from Women of Color, aka Tiara Willis, on Twitter? She is talking about this sunscreen that's strictly mineral filters. She's saying it's passing the two-finger test, which, if you don't know, a lot of people, they use a two or three-finger test to kind of measure out sunscreen instead of using like a full quarter teaspoon like I do. It's kind of like a general, like, rough guideline. Two fingers to cover the face, three to kind of incorporate the neck as well. If you're not aware, Tiara is a Black woman. She's an esthetician based out of New York, and so I was like, oh, she's saying the sunscreen's good. I definitely need to try it out, putting it on my channel, that way my audience knows. So here you are today. We're gonna be testing out the Suntique I'm Safe for Sensitive Skin SPF 35 PA 3 Pluses. Before we get into it, I'm gonna ask to hit the subscribe button and the notification bell so that you know when I post more skincare, sunscreen, fenty related content. Give this video a thumbs up, and down below, have you tried this? I had not heard of it until you sent it to me, but it's sold on Soko Glam. It seems like it's a kind of popular brand, but I just haven't heard of it. Let me know down below. Looking at this, what's really interesting to me is, first of all, there's two versions of this. This is the like safe version, I guess. And that's based off the fact that this only contains titanium dioxide. No zinc. It's only mineral filters, but it only contains titanium dioxide, only 3.57%. So it's actually a really low percentage, but we're still getting SPF 35 and a moderate amount of UVA protection, 3 pluses on a PA rating. The PA system isn't the best rating system for UVA rays. Usually PPD is a little bit more accurate because you have the star system and their values for protection are actually a little bit more higher. So having a PA of 3 pluses or 4 pluses is actually a little bit lower than a 4-star rating on the PPD rating. But that's factoring the fact that this is only titanium dioxide. Titanium dioxide doesn't have the most broad spectrum protection, but it kind of does. I really see titanium dioxide as being a fortifier for zinc, really amping up and strengthening the protection that zinc offers. So seeing it in this by itself at such a low percentage, I'm not surprised to see that lower PA rating. That being said, that's actually a very common one for mineral-based sunscreens only, even if it does have zinc. But looking at the rest of it, basically what the packaging is saying is non-chemical UV filters. It has a cica complex, somaticasticide and centella asiatica are featured in this formulation. It's easy to clean, meaning it's easy to get off, and it has zero synthetic fragrance incorporated into the formulation of it. It also says it's made for everyone, from baby to silver generation, mild and easy washable. And then before I get into the formulation, looking at Soko Glam's details, which is where I bought this from, this retails for $24. You get 1.69 fluid ounces or 50 ml. Kind of average. This gentle formula is safe for use by every age and skin type. In addition to physical blocker titanium dioxide, it also contains common ingredients like centella asiatica and aloe leaf extracts. This moisturizing sunscreen formulation instantly absorbs into the skin without leaving behind a white cast. We see that claim a lot. Greasy film or a telltale sunscreen scent. I'm not particular about sunscreens. I like a smell. I like a sunscreen smell. I don't mind a smell. I also don't mind no smell. So we'll find out a little bit about that in a second. What Soko Glam says, what the box says, and what the sunscreen says, similar, but it varies a little bit. Basically, this says non-chemical UV filters, no white cast, easy to wash off, moisturizing and cooling effect. It is a low irritation sunscreen without chemical UV filters that can be used safely for kids and sensitive skin. It reduced stickiness with soft sensation, significantly decreased white cast and moisturizing and cooling effect. So yeah, basically this is meant to be for people with like the utmost of sensitive skin. I know for a lot of people, some chemical filters, especially the US approved ones, cause irritation. For me, high percentages of zinc used very frequently throughout the week, causing my skin to be like dehydrated and irritated. So I do see irritation factors with that as well. So I'm interested to try this out. And Tiara really liked this. She shouted this out. Therefore, I'm really interested to see if it's Tiara approved, if I'm gonna like it, what my feelings for it are gonna be, and how it's gonna wear into my 4Bs sunscreen testing rubric. If you don't know, I do the 4Bs whenever I test a mineral sunscreen, and those Bs stand for beard, beading, beat, and brown skin friendly. How does it wear in the beard, facial hair, hairline, eyebrows? Is it like catching all of that? Can you tell? Beading, how does it wear with skincare underneath it? Does it bead? Does it peel? Are there weird texture issues? Beat, how does it wear into makeup? How does makeup apply on top of it? And how does it affect the overall wear of makeup throughout the day? And then brown skin friendly, does it have a cast? How severe? I'm gonna be testing this over the next 4 days. I have a very, very standard testing method where I go through and I adjust the amount of skincare underneath, the amount of makeup on top, and then I see overall how it wears throughout the first 3 days. Last day is only sunscreen, and I factor in what reapplication of it looks like on top of itself as well. So next time you see me is gonna be at the end of day 4 after I've tested it and I form my final thoughts. See you then. So here we are at the end of day 4. At this point, we're actually a couple hours after reapplication, and let's talk about this. This was one of the most conflicting experiences I've had with the sunscreen. Going back and looking at the previous 4 days of testing, again, I did a quarter teaspoon about. Actually, I did a little bit more on a couple days. And that was to cover my face, my ears, my neck. I would go in after my skincare, work that into my skin for a couple minutes, and then give each day's application 5 minutes to set down to then see after you give it some time to set how it looks and how it sets into the skin. And then I would go on top of that with whatever the makeup or whatever else I was wearing that day. Day one is my first day testing this out. You can see on the screen, I have a little measuring spoon. I got the sunscreen and I measure a quarter teaspoon. And with every first day, I always apply it to half my face first, let that sit down for 5 minutes to have a better understanding what it's going to look like covering half my face. You can compare whether or not it has a cast. I was very torn. Dispensing it into the spoon, I was like, oh, that's really white. I applied to my face and my next thought was, oh, this is like very lightweight gel texture. I could liken this to any sunscreen I've tried thus far. It's a much more lightweight texture than Comfy Water, but it's not as lightweight and thin as my Skin Aqua sunscreen, but it's a very, very lightweight gel texture. Worked it in, I was a little bit worried. And looking at the screen, you can see my face half with sunscreen, half without. And honestly, my first opinion that day was like, oh, this actually is really good. There isn't really much of a cast. This was a light skincare day, so this went over a couple hydrators. I applied it to my full face after this initial half face test, let it sit down for 5 minutes again, went on top with really light makeup, a really sheer layer, just to see coverage wise what could happen, how the makeup would apply. And the makeup applied well. My one thing with this though was my face felt tight, it felt dry. Makeup applied nicely on top of it, but after a couple hours, I had this little weird effect in the middle of my forehead where it looked like the way your skin looks like when it's peeling after a sunburn, like very like weird peely patchy skin right here. As the day progressed, it actually then began happening here by my nose. That being said, I wore a mask that day. We were out and about, it was really hot outside. So whenever I wear a mask on, I find that my skin gets really dehydrated. So I attributed some of the weird breakup to the heat and the dehydration. Makeup overall wore okay that day. Day two, that was full skincare. Hair, light beat as well. Again, with day one, I felt like my skin was really tight, really, really dry. I feel like maybe I needed to do a little bit more. So for day two, I really went in ham. I did layers of hydrators, layers of serum. I did a few different moisturizing gels and creams. Apply this on top, and it was a little bit harder to work in. This is always a weird day to test out with more skincare underneath how a mineral sunscreen is gonna work. I felt like I had to put in a little bit more elbow grease. That being said, it did work in fairly easily still. It set down really, really nice and quick. I attribute that to the really lightweight texture of this. Makeup applied again, pretty decently on top. But what always happens when I do a lot of skincare and I'm still trying to figure out a sunscreen's texture is if I don't work it into my under eye nicely, I get this really weird texture. It's not even that it peels, it's just like a very, very rough texture. And that really showed with the makeup application on top of it. My boyfriend was like, oh, your under eyes are like really, really crusty, they're crunchy. But here's the deal, using all those hydrators and all those creams, makeup were fine on top of it. But throughout the day, without a mask, we didn't leave the house this day, I still got that weird dry skin looking patchy stuff underneath the sunscreen, and my skin still felt very, very dry and tight. So I was like, okay, this is odd. The texture of this is no different than a lot of my chemical sunscreen textures, so do with that what you will. But for some reason, it didn't feel like it was really working well to like hydrate my skin. My skin still felt really dry and it looked dry, and I have oily skin. So for my skin to look dry, takes a lot. Day three was light skincare, full beat, full coverage, concealer, bronzer, contour, blush, buff on top of everything, like all that shebang. This is a day, again, I'm still trying to play around with texture, still trying to play around with how to make this really work and not get that dry, peely look. So I did a couple layers of an essence, I did a serum, a light moisturizer. I used the cactus water from Boscia this day. This on top. Then over this, I went with a setting spray, the Fenty Beauty What It Do setting spray. Let that set. Then I went on top of it with a primer. Whenever I do my full beat days, I always use a primer just to see what it's gonna do with the overall sunscreen look and the makeup wear. I let the What It Do spray set down. Then I went on top with the primer, and the primer like reactivated the sunscreen underneath it. But I was like, oh, okay, that's fine. But with that, regardless, the makeup went on actually really, really nicely. I had no weird issues with texture. Buffing it was fine for the most part, except for the primer reactivated the sunscreen. And so then going in with makeup, there was some weird patchy bits, especially after I buffed a little bit more. So while overall the makeup went on decently and it looked really good, looking up close, I had a lot of weird patching and pilling in my temples and a lot of weird stuff around my nose. I primed my eyelids using my Smashbox 24-hour eye primer, and on the eyelids it went on fine, but I did notice there were some areas of drier patching as well. So it was a very inconsistent experience. And I'm thinking at this point, I tested the sunscreen with a few different varying factors underneath it, and I'm still getting a very consistent result, but even in that, it's still very inconsistent. Like when I apply it on top, it's patchy in some parts, but it looks fine in other parts. But then the next day, it's inconsistently patchy in different parts. It doesn't make sense. That being said, buffing in other areas, I didn't have any issue, especially down here. I could buff contour and bronzer just fine. Makeup wore well, it set down well. My face was very matte throughout most of the day. At least I felt. On camera, it might look different. But my skin still felt very tight. And I had no weird breaking up issues down here, but you can see at the end of day three, I had to zoom in and show. Weird dry peeling patchy thing on my forehead was really pronounced this day. And we got a close up of it so you can see. It didn't look this way when I first started out. That ended up that way in the progression of the day. So I don't know what causes that, but it gets more uncute the longer you wear. Here we are, day four. Day four is light skincare, sunscreen only, no makeup on top. So that way you can see what it looks like on bare skin, plus reapplication so you see how it reapplies on itself. So today, again, we're trying to play with more skincare, trying to figure out how to diminish that weird peeling texture that I get on my forehead. So I went with a couple layers of a different hydrator, a serum, and then I did two different moisturizers. I did the Crave Beauty Great Barrier Relief, as well as the Stradia Liquid Gold. And both of those are really nice emollient rich moisturizers that really nourish the skin without being too heavy. So I was hopeful that they would really moisturize my skin, give me those nice moisturizing properties without being too much for my oily skin. And I will say that actually did work. Today, the sunscreen went on, no patching, no pilling, no weird texture issues. It actually looked really, really good on the first application. You can see on the screen. And I find this really doesn't leave much of a white cast. With the reapplication, a couple hours in, I really didn't have a lot of an issue either. The main difference I noticed, something that got more pronounced as I went out to look in natural light, my boyfriend pointed out, was that I look paler. It's not really a tone up, it's not a white cast, I just looked a little bit paler. But it's not bad, and even looking at it now, like, again, this is with reapplication, this is actually still passable. It's barely in my hairline, barely in my beard line, and my skin still looks really good. But what I will say, I haven't blotted, I still look radiant, but I'm not oily or greasy at all. But whenever I move my face is doing that thing where, like, when your skin looks really dry and it looks kind of scaly, I'm getting a lot of that right here. So breaking down my four B's, which again is beard, beading, beats, brown skin friendly. Let's start with beard. I've had varying results with this. Sometimes I do it and I think it looks fine. When my boyfriend called it, I was like, oh, it's in like the perimeters of your beard. Then other days, like today, I work it in a couple layers into my hairline and it looks pretty fine. Like this isn't bad at all. It doesn't collect in my eyebrow or mustache very badly. It's a super, super lightweight texture. In that regard, it's pretty good. Beading, how I worked with skincare of varying nature underneath it. I'm still torn. I guess you have to use really emollient rich moisturizers and make sure your skin itself is moisturized. You can't rely on this as being a moisturizing factor as a moisturizer plus sunscreen all in one. You have to make sure your skin is adequately moisturized underneath, I guess, for it to work. But even still, the day I did full skincare, I still got that weird drying situation up here. So I'm not entirely sure what the actual combination is going to be to get this to look the best just yet. But today's Liquid Gold plus the Great Barrier Relief was a really nice result. So this is still iffy and I'm not sure what the answer is to get this to work the best that it can. It doesn't peel, but it gets this weird dry texture. And plus right now, again, my skin doesn't feel like the most adequately moisturized. Beat, how it wears a makeup. For the most part, I don't got a lot of negative results. What I will say is this has to look good underneath the makeup first for the makeup to look good on top of it. I found is that makeup doesn't apply on this weird, doesn't affect necessarily the way it sits on the skin. If you buff or anything on top of it, this just has to be good on the skin first. Because there's really no white cast to this, it doesn't adjust or alter the coloring of the foundation. Honestly, with how this makes my skin really, really matte throughout the day in the sense of like dehydrating it, it keeps my shine at bay. It makes things look good for a long time and it wears well with primers. I noticed my eyelids didn't get creasy. My under eyes, as long as they were smooth with the sunscreen on top before makeup, they were pretty good. Yeah, I have no complaints with the makeup part. This worked really fine with makeup. And then brown skin friendly. I think this is low-key a banger. Again, the reason I discovered this is because my boyfriend sent me a link to Makeup for Women of Color, aka Tiara's post, talking about how this passed her two-finger test and she's a black woman with really nice rich skin and it looks good for her and she likes it. I was hopeful. I just wanted to make sure it'd be like oily skin friendly, makeup friendly, the things I test for, beard friendly. And so far, like, I have no issues with the cast. I could wear this by itself and not have an issue. Even with reapplication, I'm not having much of an issue. This is low-key like day wearable. I don't think it's that clockable. So brown skin friendly, yes, coming from me and also from Makeup for Women of Color, aka Tiara. Like, if she likes it, if she approves it, then this definitely could work for a lot of deeper skin tones. What I will say for this though, and this has happened a couple times with a few different sunscreens, there have been sunscreens that have left white casts on me that on darker skin tones, individuals have been like, oh, it works great for me. And what I'm finding is that it comes down to potentially skin type. For example, the Biossance, the Pipette, those are sunscreens that they leave white casts on me, but they're also very, very rich emollient oil-based textures that I feel work better for drier skin. And therefore, I feel like if they work better for dry skin, maybe the vehicles allow the pigments and the filters in those to look better on deeper skin. Whereas for me as an oily skin individual, because those vehicles don't work well for my skin type, the filters don't sit down properly and that's why they leave that cast on me. So do with that what you will. That being said, this looks like it's a good all around skin type sunscreen. Therefore, I don't have a doubt this could work really well for deeper skin tones. So my overall thoughts on this, I didn't hate this. Going off some of the stuff, this is an SPF 35, only 3 PA pluses, which the PA system itself isn't the most thorough system for UVA protection rating. But even still, with this only being titanium dioxide, and I know the extent of what titanium dioxide can do as a filter and whatnot, this is adequate, but it's not my preferred type of filter. That being said, considering this is a mineral only filter that is decent adequate SPF, SPF 35, with such a lightweight texture, no white cast, you could comfortably put on too much and have it set down really nicely. And in that, you guarantee you're getting adequate protection. On the first day, actually, because I didn't feel like I put on enough, I actually went in with more than just a quarter teaspoon on my face, and I still feel like that looked really, really good. So the texture of this allows you to put on a very generous amount. It sets down beautifully, and therefore with that, guaranteeing that you're getting adequate protection, I would recommend this for that in itself. This doesn't advertise using non-nano filters, and so that might be a reason why it has no white cast, even though it is titanium dioxide. For me, titanium dioxide, I feel, is a little bit more of a stark white finish than just zinc oxide. So if nanoparticles matter to you, maybe this might not be for you. But that being said, nanoparticles aren't bad for you. The formulation for this is a super, super lightweight gel. It sinks in beautifully to the skin. It's not moisturizing though. So if you have dry skin, you really gotta go ham. Make sure your skin's really adequately nourished and moisturized. But even with me, with my oily skin, like, this left me feeling dry, and I rarely ever feel dry. So that's a little bit concerning to me. But it's all around just a very basic sunscreen formulation. It's very gentle, it's very lightweight. This is a 1.69 fluid ounce, aka 50 ml bottle. Average price for this is ranging about $20. So this is really recommended in that it checks a lot of things people look for in sunscreens, and it's not my preferred type of formula, but I could settle for this. This actually worked really, really well for me. Therefore, because I feel like it could work for a large population of people and that it actually is a little bit more towards the sensitive skin friendly side, I'm pretty sure this is fragrance free. This is decently affordable. I would say this is Ramon recommended. It's a really nice formula. It's not my preferred, it's not my favorite, but it's something I will settle to use if I need to. It still isn't 100% perfect mineral sunscreen. I'm still on the hunt for that, but it actually passes a lot of my criteria enough for me to be like, oh, I like it, it's decent. It doesn't cling in my facial hair horribly. It wears under makeup decently. It works pretty decently with most skincare. I'm trying to figure out that little parameter. Reapplies nicely on itself and it leaves no white cast. Like, very, 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 very minimal, if any, white cast. Mainly it just makes you look a little bit pale. So all in all, I didn't hate this. This is actually a really nice option. I got this off of SokoGlam. Currently right now it's actually sold out on SokoGlam. So I'll put a couple different other retailers down below as well. But overall, Suntiques, I'm safe for sensitive skin, is in fact safe for sensitive skin, and was kind of a home run. I didn't hate it. It was kind of an odd review, I'm gonna be honest. Like, looking back at the last few days, I'm like, I kind of liked it, but I didn't like it, but it wasn't bad, but it wasn't great. So I'm like kind of torn on this, but overall, I think it passes. It got a C+. Don't forget, hit that subscribe button, notification bell, so that you know when I post more sunscreen, skincare, Fenty related content. Give this video a thumbs up. And down below, have you tried this? What were your thoughts on it? Have you tried their other version, like the Cica Complex one? Let me know about that one, because that one caught my eye, but this one was the higher priority. And did you find this review interesting? Let me know. Thanks for watching, guys. Bye.